direct from Southern California, the car capital of the world, the Auto Channel presents exclusive press pass coverage of the Los Angeles Auto Show.
Hey, inside the world of electric cars, the advancements continue. We're here at the Wheego Electric Car Display for the Auto Channel, standing by with a great interview here with Mike McQuary. And Mike, you are the president, founder?
I'm the CEO and founder of Wheego Electric Cars.
And you're very excited about what your press conference was today and some earth-shaking news coming out here about not going along with the crowd with a lithium-ion battery. You're unique right out the gate with the type of battery selection you went with. Can you tell us on an opening point when we talk about electric cars, you know, the battery race continues. Here you are breaking away with lithium iron?
Yeah, it's the same family of chemistry in the lithium chemistry, but we're using lithium iron instead of lithium ion or lithium ion phosphate. So we give up a little bit of power density, but it's a much safer battery pack. We don't have runaway thermal issues. If you'll remember a few years ago, there were laptop computers that were catching on fire. That was the lithium ion chemistry.
Because they continue to be used today.
Yeah. And if you have a proper cooling system, you're fine. But you need an elaborate cooling system. We just figured that was one more thing that we didn't want people to have to worry about. So we're using lithium iron technology. And that's the name of the car. It's the LiFe. That's the chemical symbol for lithium, and then you got a capital FE, which is the chemical symbol for iron. So thus, the Wheego LiFe is a lithium iron battery powered car.
Very fun name for a car, combining the chemical terms with the reality of what the fun name is, and obviously pointing out to the environmental concerns of sustainability, life for all of us on a small planet.
Absolutely.
Now, the vehicle also has some impressive performance figures. We heard at the press conference you referenced 70 miles per hour. That's not normally the territory of what we call the golf cart electric cars. Talk about the performance.
Yeah, it'll go 100 miles on a charge. It'll actually go faster than 70 miles per hour, but in the software, we've capped it at 70 miles per hour. It's a really peppy car. It's actually got a drive mode that'll give you the best optimal range, but it's also got a sport mode. So if you want to sit at a traffic light and use that instantaneous torque that electric gives you, you'll run almost any sports car that you see to the next traffic light.
So the 0 to 60 time, have you actually run a number?
We've not. But there's a couple people who have used this technology at drag racing. If you go online and look up the white zombie car, you'll see sort of how impressive battery, instant torque, speed can be off the line.
I think the performance car enthusiasts out there can appreciate that electric vehicles offer, while they don't have the sound of, say, a Ferrari or a Corvette roaring down the road, the performance of instant torque is there. What's the kilowatt? What's the measurement? What's the spec on the motor?
Sure. It's the battery pack is a 30 kilowatt motor. And then when you talk about electric motors in terms of horsepower, it sounds just really shallow. I mean, we have a 20 horsepower AC motor in it.
You know, it's the torque that really moves the...
Yeah, it's the torque that moves it, and you know, it'll run as high as 60 horsepower, which again, when you start thinking of internal combustion cars, you're like, no, where's the beef? But once you're in the car, you'll see that the thing just snaps with that instant electric torque, and that's really what you're looking for.
So you could do a burnout, and the noisiest thing would be the tires, not the engine.
Absolutely.
Now, you are excited about also explaining to the audience here that there is a joy in coming out in the marketplace where, for example, today the GM, the Chevrolet Volt, was celebrated as the green car of the year. And I think people out there would appreciate you're talking about how excited you are to say, you know, that's kind of neat, but we have a different spin on the spin. What's the spin?
Yeah, I think it's interesting that the Chevrolet Volt won Motor Trend's Car of the Year. And as I understand it, it barely nosed out George Jetson's flying car, which is also coincidentally not yet commercially available. And I just scratch my head and wonder, how do you give the car of a year to a car that's not even on the market yet?
Well, now, how do you shake that out with your feeling about launching your first vehicle here? What's the history of your company? I mean, in a sense, they've got the legacy, but your joke on the point here, if I'm getting it, is when you roll it out of the showroom and prove it in the marketplace a bit, we'll feel better. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, they've never sold a car.
Yeah.
The press have driven them around, but they've never sold a single car. So
we're just so excited about a car that comes out. It's such a cool car, I guess, right?
Right. Okay. So you know, my take is let's at least have something that people can buy.
Yeah.
You know, you pick up Motor Trend Car of the Year, you go to buy one and they say it's not available yet. And our car is going to be available in about 30 days. So hopefully they've raised awareness about electric cars, but I do find it a little perplexing that you can win Car of the Year with a vehicle that's you're not able to even buy.
We're changing the way awards are given. Just get used to it, okay?
Yeah. You know, the other take I had is if other people pick up on that cue, Daniel Stern, the commissioner of the NBA, just awarded the 2011 championship to the Miami Heat, so we're not even going to play the season.
Get used to it, right? Just a new order. You know, it's also notable that as you talk about this car in relationship to awards and recognition of electric cars, how do you differentiate yourself from the competition in the electric car world? This is becoming not a crowded segment, but a growing segment. You've got Nissan, you've got General Motors, you've got obviously you've got Tesla.
Yep.
The manufacturers out there are all vying for the same consumers who are cutting-edge pioneers in the market. How do you differentiate yourself?
Yeah, a couple different ways. With Tesla, I think it's a marvelous piece of engineering, but the car costs over $100,000. So if you're having a midlife crisis and you want to offset that guilt with some eco-consciousness, by all means, go buy a Tesla. But it's not exactly an affordable car, so that's one big differentiation. I've also heard that their CEO is a genius, and I'm clearly not, so that's another differentiation.
I have to say, I understand from a little bit of information before we talk that you come from a background of continual innovation. Tell the audience a little bit about what they should know, that you're not coming in here with your first effort at innovation and enterprise. What else have you launched?
Yeah, I'm a technology guy, and I was one of the guys at the very beginning of Mindspring Internet Service, and when we launched that, our competitors were IBM and AT&T and the Bell companies.
You're not intimidated by big blue chip brands.
Yeah, people keep coming to me saying, how are you going to compete with General Motors and Ford? I'm like, well, at least my old competitive set were not financially hobbled. These guys may be big, but, you know, financially, based on what they've done the last few years, it's hard to be too intimidated.
You can only go up from here.
Yeah, that's what I think. And we're not trying to be the biggest. Everybody wants to sell cars and be the biggest.
Yeah.
We just want to be the company that has the happiest customers. And if we can do that, the number of cars I want to sell next year is a number that all the other executives would get fired if they only sold that many cars.
You're setting a target of what?
We'd like to sell a couple thousand cars next year.
Okay,
we'd be perfectly happy, and I want to have the happiest customers out there. I want them to be evangelical about the car. I want them to tell their friends at work and their neighbors.
This is a social network this is a blog mobile.
Yeah, it's viral marketing is going to be the most important thing. When we get these cars on the road and everybody sees them and you get a chance to drive your neighbor's car, you're going to start thinking, maybe I should get an electric car and maybe I should get a Wheego. So that viral marketing uptake is going to be huge. So it definitely borrows liberally from my background in technology.
And it's going to be a first in the block to own one, but also opinion leaders. You have influential people that will buy these. That's going to be a factor. I think the mainstream audience that might be out there wondering about price point would wonder, okay, cool car, unique, batteries that are less inclined to be volatile, shall we say.
Absolutely.
But price point and dealer distribution and launch and where will we see these?
Sure. The price point on it is $32,995 before you get your federal and state tax rebate. So you've got a federal tax rebate of $7,500. If you're in some of the more aggressive states like Georgia or California, you're going to get another $5,000. So the car, for most people, is going to net down in the low 20s. So I think it's a very affordable car, which helps a lot. Other cars that are out there, the only one that's comparably priced is the Nissan LiFe. And I think they make a great car. If you're thinking about buying an electric car, you should absolutely look at the Nissan LiFe. I think Carlos Ghosn's the smartest executive in the auto industry. And as America is struggling to recover from our economic downturn, if you're comfortable with your dollar going to a Japanese company, by all means, go buy a Nissan LiFe.
Yeah.
Now, if you want an American alternative,
this is U.S. built, right? I understand it is.
This is U.S. built. It's over 75% U.S. content.
Okay.
So it's an American car made with American ingenuity by American entrepreneurs.
And the parts are international, shall we say?
Yeah, only the car body. Yeah, some of the parties from, we looked for best-in-class suppliers regardless of where they were, but with an eye towards always favoring a U.S. supplier. So we've got 30 different suppliers and 27 of them are U.S. suppliers. From a dealer distribution network, we've got 22 car dealers spread out across the country, so we're going to sell in every market. Nissan's going to sell in 7 or 8 markets. The Volt will be available, I think, in 8 markets, and that's the only place you're going to be able to buy one of those cars. By the way, that Volt is not an electric car. I mean, that's a hybrid, and I was going to give them a pass and not call them out, but their first ad campaign they came out with featured the tagline, peace of mind, obviously making a jab at people who are worried about range anxiety. So given that that's the jab they're going to make, I'm going to call them out. You put gasoline in it, it has emissions and exhaust fumes that come out of it. And in my view, if it looks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, then quack, quack, you are a duck. So that's right. A hybrid.
Sounds like you're not sold yet on it.
No, it's a hybrid car. Yeah. I think it's a wonderful advanced hybrid car.
So an advanced hybrid works for you, but not full electric. You're not looking at it as...
It's not a full electric car. You put gasoline into it, and it spits out emissions, which is sort of the proposition we're trying to get away with electric cars. Let's end our dependency on foreign oil. Yeah. Let's help the environment by not throwing pollutants up into it. Yeah. And they've taken one step towards it, but good grief, they're General Motors. You know, let's make a bold statement. Let's not tiptoe around when you're General Motors.
And you know, on balance, the exciting thing for everybody out there to appreciate is that this is all incremental. We're making progress toward a uniform and unilateral agreed goal of shaking off the problem with the batteries. And you're working on that with a lithium iron.
Yes.
I want to say a lithium ion. The charging station that I see behind you, is that station that I look at here, is that something people can buy for their garage or just incidentally?
Yeah, that's a residential charger. And one smart thing that the industry did, to your point of everybody working together to make incremental positive steps, is all the car manufacturers, all the charger manufacturers agreed that we're going to use one international standard for charging.
So we're all can use that.
Yeah, we're all using what's called the J1772 standard. So the plug and the socket is always going to be compatible. You won't have the old, what was it, the VHS versus beta, you know, problem that we had.
We're all in this together.
Yeah. Okay. So no matter where you pull into, no matter whose charging station it is, no matter which car you have, you'll be able to plug in. So that's a big step to get over that hurdle, because trying to get this group together and agree on anything, you know, they can't even agree on what to have for lunch. So to get an engineer,
uniform OBD2 with a uniform connector to diagnose cars, but can we agree on how to charge them and how to distribute the electricity and get the infrastructure moving toward hydrogen, which is a long-term goal?
Yeah, well, that was a great first step, was getting that compatibility in the plug. So, and it's been a little bit of a chicken and the egg. I don't blame the charger people for not running out and building a public charging infrastructure when the only street legal car up till now has been the Tesla. Yeah. And there's, you know, maybe 1,000 of those in operation around the U.S. It didn't make a lot of sense.
Demand has to dictate the future.
Right. But now the chickens are here, and it's time for, you know, us to start rolling out eggs, because this car is going to be on the road in 30 days. And I think you'll see a proliferation of electric cars starting to hit the market over the next couple of years. So it's time to get that infrastructure built out.
Is there a website or somewhere you want people to go next if they're on the web right now to search out more information? Besides the Auto Channel, must be great resources that you want people to go to for your website?
Yeah, actually, if you go to our website, we'll link you into a lot of educational material, both on chargers and other electric cars and everything else. Because at this point, I believe a rising tide lifts all boats. I want all electric car companies to do well. So I'm not going to slam anybody else's electric car. I'm going to talk about the differences and the virtues of ours. But if you go to www.wheego.net, and Wheego's WHEEGO.net, you'll find a bunch of information, and you'll see in our mission statement, our mission is to educate people about electric cars. And we take that task very seriously, because we believe a smarter consumer is going to make good decisions that are going to benefit everybody.
Very well put, and a noble goal for Mike McQuary from Wheego Electric Cars. I have to tell you, Mike, thank you very much.
You bet. Thanks for being interested in it and helping spread the word.
We're very excited about what you're doing and all the electric car manufacturers. And I can't help but have fun with what other people are inevitably going to have fun with. But where do we go next? With the Auto Channel, I'm Steve Ford, the car guy. Let's go look around some more here at the LA Auto Show.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great coverage of all major motor events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive resource.